Your body there would not remain. Our God has robbed the grave. Our God has robbed the Would you join with me in this confession time? Together, let's say this. As if it were not enough, Almighty God, creator of the universe, that you should, through the power of your word, call into being that all that is known and all that remains to be discovered. As if that were not enough, you continue to hold the majesty of the heavens in the hollow of your hand. And we, creatures made of clay, hold ourselves as gods, believing ourselves to be the center of the universe, greater than the God who created all things. As if that were not enough, you filled your earth with people made in your own image and likeness. Yet we, the people made in your image and your likeness, treat the gift of life with arrogance, often holding ourselves as overlords of creation rather than stewards entrusted with our master's treasure. As if it were not enough, Almighty and loving God, that you should create men and women. As if that were not enough, you chose to reveal generation by generation the one to wanderers in deserts and inhabitants of ancient cities the truth of your Godhead. And we, heirs to the great story, are forgetful and dismissive of our heritage. As if that were not enough, when the hearts of humanity were hard and rebellious, you sent your Son, the only begotten, to enter our history and redeem it. As if it were not enough, Almighty and loving God, that through the death and resurrection of your one and only Son, our beloved Savior, all creation should be redeemed. We praise you, Jesus, for living a life we could not live and dying a death we could not die. And thanks be to God. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when spheres are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, the fullness of God in helpless babe, his gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. Thank you. light of the world by darkness slain, and bursting forth in the glorious day. Oh, up from the grave he rose again, and as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his, and with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand, till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand, till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I stand. It's in that power that we can meet tonight, Lord. We remembered on Ash Wednesday that we are broken, that we are dust that's blown away by the wind, but you, O Lord, are the creator of dust. You, our Lord, saw it fit to give us life. And so this evening we're recognizing that you did something that we could not do. You, Jesus, lived a life that we cannot live, and you died a death in our place, as we just said. In our place you stood condemned. You who knew no sin became sin for us, so we might become the righteousness of Christ. So this evening we recognize that. And we're asking you to move in us greatly this evening, to remind us anew what you have done for us, so that we might respond with our lives. So don't let us leave here unchanged. Move in us. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you.
There's a growing fear, not just here in America, but worldwide, about cyber attacks. We've been hearing about it for years. The vulnerability of America's cyber grid, which has become an even hotter topic in the past couple of months, given the war in Ukraine and the reemergence of the conflict we find ourselves in with Russia. Personally, I don't think I can comprehend all the ramifications and repercussions of our grid going down. Economic collapse, national security risks to refineries and chemical plants, sewer systems, traffic lights, and public transportation would stop working. Healthcare for those in hospitals would be fully dependent on generators, putting millions at risk. We can't even begin to imagine the disruption in our lives. A little closer to home for most of us is the fear of identity fraud, what it could end up doing to us and costing us. Some of the most recent studies say that hackers steal someone's personal data every 39 seconds, and the average victim loses $10,000. I guess it's why everywhere I turn, someone is offering me fraud protection. My credit card companies, I just heard about an app that you can get for your smartphones, because now there's so much information stored on our mobile devices, and most of us haven't even thought of getting the same kind of virus and malware protection that we have on our computers, which is a shame because the data on our phones is probably more at risk than what's stored on our home computer. As sinister and scary as cyber attacks are, at least there are a lot of folks out there who are taking it seriously. People who aren't just crying wolf, but who know how real of a threat it poses. And so they're sounding an alarm, urging us to do something about it, to take some action before it's too late and we become another statistic on the list of victims. You know, it's a shame that we don't take sin that seriously. Its prominence and prevalence, that it's invading and influencing every area of our lives, whether or not we realize it. That it poses so much a greater threat than most of the things we tend to worry about, things like inflation, rising interest rates, and the price of gas. And that failing to recognize just how real a threat sin poses and not building the proper safeguards into our lives leaves us vulnerable to its attack. This weekend is a perfect example. Most churches like ours have twice as many Easter worship gatherings as they do for Good Friday. Some churches don't even have a worship gathering on Good Friday. Perhaps it's because of culture's growing disdain for the biblical view of sin that we've become so fragile as a society that we avoid any conversation that might even possibly make persons feel bad about themselves instead of affirming whatever they do. We don't even like to say the word sin. It feels so Old Testament, so judgmental. At any rate, however many people are here in worship tonight for Good Friday to come face to face with sin, there'll be many more here on Easter, celebrating the joy and hope of the resurrection. You see, Easter not only has an empty tomb, but egg-laying bunnies and buffet brunches. It offers new sets of clothes to wear and baskets of chocolate candy to open, and all Good Friday offers is a cross. But there's a reason the cross is the central symbol of the Christian faith. There's a reason you have chosen not to skip past this time of worship and reflection, not to do the Holy Week hop from Palm Sunday to Easter. Because consciously or unconsciously, you know that sin has power over us, that it carries a penalty, and that someone has to pay the price. And what makes Good Friday good is that Jesus has done for us what we could never do for ourselves, save us from what the scriptures call slavery to sin and death, and deliver us into freedom and life, life abundant and eternal. And so tonight we're going to spend some time reflecting on the significance of the cross, why God sent his one and only Son to do so much more than just teach us to cope with our problems, or to help us feel better about ourselves, or to boost our self-esteem. Why God sent Jesus to offer his body and blood to deal with our most fundamental, pervasive, and eternally devastating problem, and that is sin. sin has a power. Truthfully, our view of sin tends to be way too small. For many, sin is just a word that describes naughty deeds, but it's so much more. Sin is bigger than bad words, larger than doing things we shouldn't do or not doing the things we should. Sin is more than stepping over a moral line. To sin is to be captivated and captured by the larger forces which oppose God, and to join them in doing their bidding. It's stacking hands with the very enemy of our soul. It's becoming a foot soldier in a vast, overwhelming army of destruction that seeks the death of all human life. The power of sin is deeper than just its pervasiveness, that it has affected each and every human being since the beginning of time. As the Apostle Paul writes in Romans chapter 3, verse 23, that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Sin is a power that captures our mind and enslaves our heart. Even when we know in our minds that God wants us to treat everyone with respect, we often fall prey to thinking that we can get ahead by speaking poorly about a coworker. Mothers and fathers know that getting angry and yelling at our kids isn't good, but there are times when the power of sin overtakes us and we do so anyway, right? Or how we're tempted not to report all of our income or claim deductions that don't apply to us when we're filling out our taxes, even though we know lying and stealing are things we teach our kids are wrong. That once we give the devil a foothold in our lives, he not only puts a foot in the door, but plants a seed in our mind, and it grows roots in our heart, growing weeds that weaken our resolve and choke out our desire for the things of God. It's why the Apostle Paul, one of the most committed Jesus followers in all of history, someone who wrote what we now know as Scripture about the insidious power of sin, even Paul could not escape its influence. And so in Romans chapter 7, he writes, "I do not understand what I do, for I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. For I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I do not want to do, this I keep on doing." Can you relate? "Now if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it, but it is sin living in me that does it." Sin has a power. And not just that, sin has a penalty. Sadly, as few people out there today who acknowledge the reality of sin, that it's an actual power at work in our lives, there are even fewer who realize how seriously God takes our sin, that there are consequences that will be enforced, that sin has a penalty. Imagine if there weren't penalties for breaking the rules. What if hockey players weren't sent to the penalty box for hitting an opposing player in the head with their stick? Or if a soccer referee only issued yellow cards and just kept warning players about misconduct or overly aggressive acts instead of also issuing a red card? The red card penalizes the player by removing him or her from the game, and it also penalizes the team who has to play the rest of the game with one less player on the field. Imagine if there weren't penalties, real consequences for driving while intoxicated, armed robbery, or cheating on our taxes. We wouldn't take the rules seriously, right? And there'd be chaos, anarchy. Not only do we need authority, a set of rules, but there has to be accountability. Consequences have to be enforced. Penalties have to be levied. In Romans chapter 6, verse 23, the Apostle Paul shares the penalty of sin. He says, "For the wages of sin is death." That death he speaks of might be the separation we feel from the one who sinned against us or who we sinned against, death in one of our relationships. Sin also creates a separation in our relationship with God, one that might be temporary here on earth, but also could be eternal, permanent separation in hell if the sin isn't dealt with and the penalty isn't paid. Friends, this is why God sent his Son. And we're going to see in tonight's scripture from our Route 22 journey through the Gospel of Matthew that Jesus has the authority. Jesus has the authority to cancel, to put away once and for all the power and the penalty of sin. Last weekend, we walked our way through Matthew 8, and we saw how Jesus' authority expanded, how it went from just having people amazed at the authority of his teaching to every area of life, authority over sickness, authority over evil spirits and the demonic, authority over Jews and Gentiles, authority over the wind and the waves of the sea, over all creation. And as we turn to chapter 9, we see Jesus exercising authority over humanity's most pressing problem, sin. Jesus gets in the boat with his disciples and heads to his hometown of Capernaum. Some men brought to Jesus a paralyzed man lying on a mat. And when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the man, "Take heart, son, your sins are forgiven." At this, some of the teachers of the law and the Pharisees said to themselves, "This fellow is blaspheming." Blasphemy is showing disrespect for sacred and holy things, especially God. The height of blasphemy was for a human being to claim to be God. And so here, the teachers of the law are charging Jesus with this offense because he claimed to offer the paralyzed man forgiveness for his sins, something that only God could do. And so knowing their thoughts, Jesus said, "Why do you entertain evil thoughts in your hearts? Which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven, or to say, get up and walk?" So in Jesus' day, sickness was always seen as a result of sin, and people mistakenly believed that folks didn't get well from a sickness until they were forgiven of their sins. The forgiveness was purchased through making a sacrifice to God, the only one who could forgive sin. Sacrifice was the business of the temple priests in Jerusalem. 6 days a week, priests sacrificed bulls, lambs, goats, doves, and pigeons because sin required an offering of blood. Blood symbolized life in order to make atonement to God. At any rate, Jesus accepts the challenge. He asks, "Which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven, or to say, get up and walk?" In other words, it would actually be harder to say get up and walk if the man hadn't first been forgiven of his sins. As I said, the common assumption of the day was that sin had to be dealt with before sickness could be healed. So if the man got up and walked, it was unanswerable proof that his sins had been forgiven. So Jesus uses the authority his Father had given him to forgive the man of his sins, which then triggered the healing of his disease. He says, "But I want you to know that the Son of Man has," say that word with me, "has authority." Authority on earth to what? To forgive sins. So he said to the paralyzed man, "Get up, take your mat, and go home." Then the man got up and went home. When the crowd saw this, they were filled with awe, and they praised God who had given such authority to man. Friends, Jesus has the authority to cancel the power and the penalty of sin. Because he is God, because he lived a sinless life, because he sacrificed his life to pay the price. As the Apostle Paul writes so clearly in Colossians chapter 2, "When you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sins," having, say that word with me, "having canceled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us. He has taken it away, nailing it to the cross, and having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross." Sin has a power. Sin has a penalty. And so the question we're trying to help all of us ask tonight is just, are you aware of the power and the penalty of your own sin? J.C. Ryle says, "Christ is never fully valued until sin is clearly seen." Christ is never fully valued until sin is clearly seen. In other words, it's hard to save someone who doesn't know that they're lost in the first place. Do you remember how desperately lost you were until Jesus found you? The invitation tonight is to hand over your sin to your Savior, to the one who has authority, the exousia, the right to cancel the power and the penalty of sin. Instead of trying to fight the battle in your own flesh, your own willpower, instead of continuing to try to pay the price for your sin with guilt and shame, or worse, trying to avoid sin, minimize it, rationalize it, blame others, only to have it continue to dominate you and wreak destruction in your soul. Instead, would you do something different? Make the decision today to protect your grid, to make it far less vulnerable and susceptible to a devastating attack. Put your trust and hope in the one who's demonstrated his authority over sickness, evil spirits and demons, the wind and the waves of creation, and ultimately over sin itself. Yes, sin has a power. Yes, sin has a penalty. But the good news is that Jesus has the authority to cancel the power and the penalty of sin. And so tonight, we want you to get up, to take your mat and to walk, to hand over your sin to your Savior. Because where there is forgiveness, there is freedom. Would you pray with me? Most gracious God, we thank you so much for your Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ, and the way that you sent him to save us from our sins, to pay our penalty, to die our death. And so tonight, we have the opportunity to think about something that we often don't like to think about, and that is the S word, right? The power and the penalty that comes with our sin. And so God, we ask that you would grant us the wisdom to know what you're calling us to do, and then the courage, God, to faithfully follow you wherever that takes us. I pray for all of us who are a part of this worship experience tonight in this room, those who are watching this online now or later, God, we ask that you would help us to take Good Friday seriously. That we would understand the power and the penalty of our sin, because we believe that you are most valued when our sin is most clearly seen. God, I pray that you would then help us to understand that you don't leave us there, that you invite us to hand over our sin to you as our Savior and to experience not just forgiveness, but freedom. And so as we continue to pray tonight, hopefully you have not only been confronted with the reality of your sin, but also, even more importantly, with the depth of the love of a God who cared about you so much that he wanted to take care of that sin. He wanted to cancel it. He wanted to put it away once and for all. And so if you'd like to respond to that action by receiving a relationship with Jesus or renewing your commitment to Christ, would you just pray with me right now? God, we're sorry for the things in our life that are wrong. We confess, we fall short, we mess up, we make mistakes, we are sinners. That's why we're so grateful, God, that you sent your son Jesus to pay our penalty, to die our death, to save us from our sins. God, we receive Jesus as Savior and as Lord, and we ask that you would fill us now with the presence and the power of your Holy Spirit, that we would live for you each and every day of our lives. And we pray all this in the mighty, in the matchless name of your son, Jesus. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread, and after he'd given thanks to God the Father, he broke the bread and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which has been broken for you. Do this as often as you eat it in remembrance of me." Likewise, after the supper was over, Jesus took the cup, and after he'd given thanks to God the Father, he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant. It's been poured out for you and for the whole world for forgiveness of sins. So do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Would you pray with me? Almighty God, we ask that you would pour out your Holy Spirit on all of us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and the fruit of the vine. We ask that you would make them to be for us your body and your blood, that we would be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. And by your Spirit, God, make us one with you and one with each other and one in ministry to all the world until you return in your final victory and we feast, God, at your great heavenly banquet. We pray all this in the name of your Son, Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen." Let me share a couple of quick words with you in terms of instructions. If you're new to the way, if it's been a while since you've celebrated communion with us, in just a couple of moments, when I'm done talking, you'll be dismissed for communion a row at a time by a member of our guest services team. If you come up here toward the front, we have a couple of communion stations where you can receive a piece of the bread. You can then dip the bread into the cup. Our cup has grape juice in it, if that's helpful for you to know. And then you can return to your seat. If it's difficult for you to come forward, please just let a member of our team know that. We'd be happy to bring communion to you right where you are. If you desire pre-sealed or gluten-free communion, that's available at our station in the back of the room. So when your row moves, you can just head back to that spot. As we have the opportunity tonight, not just to think about the power and the penalty of our sin, but the one who cancels that power and penalty forever. We want you to know how wide and long and high and deep is God's love for you. And so we invite you to come and taste and see the goodness and love of Jesus. Won't you come? Thank you.
you join me for one more song? How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns His face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. My sin upon His shoulders, ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held Him there until dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no. But I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an paid my ransom. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom.
I want to say thanks to each and every one of you for being here tonight and remind you that while it's Friday, Sunday's coming. And hope that you'll be here with us for Sunday worship, Easter Sunday here at The Way, 9:30 and 11 a.m. It is not too late to consider who's that one person in your life, that one person who doesn't realize how much God loves them, isn't living out the implications of that love in their daily life. An ordinary invitation from you could have an extraordinary impact. And so we hope to see you Sunday. Receive this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up His countenance upon you and grant to you His peace. Amen.